Hey, church family, welcome to Wednesday Night Bible Study. I'm so glad to be joining you today. We've got a beautiful background. It's a beautiful day out. And this is actually my community dog park in our development where we live. But it's perfect for the study that we're going to do today. But first, we're going to dive into some worship. I'd like to thank Beth Ann Clinton and Dana Dugas for coming together to film and record a couple of worship songs for us for this Wednesday night. So I'm going to open in prayer, and then if you would, worship with us, stand up where you are, and just let's go to the Lord in a time of worship, and then we'll open up the Word and dig into the study for this evening. All right, so I'm going to open in prayer, and we're going to get started. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to be here once again, Lord, and to be able to come together with technology and electronically, Lord, that we can still gather together in homes across our county and across surrounding counties, Lord, and even in other states, Father, and those who consider this church their home church, Father. Lord, we love you today, and we just pray that your blessing would be on each and every one of us as we worship. Lord, we just invite your presence into our homes, into our place, wherever we are, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, church. Let's worship.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to the Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to the Lord. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will win. I'm not backing down from any giant. I know how this story ends. Turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for
prosper.
When darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Oh, my God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. Beautiful Lord, wonderful Savior, I know for sure all of my days are held in your hands, crafted into your perfect plan. You gently call me into your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me, dear Lord, to live all of my life through your eyes. I'm captured by your holy calling. Bend me apart. I know you're drawing me to yourself. Lead me, Lord, I pray. Take me, mold me, use me, fill me. I give my life to the potter's hand. Call me, guide me, lead me, walk beside me. I give my life to the potter's hand. You gently call me into your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me, dear Lord, to live all of my life through by your holy calling. Set me apart. I know you're drawing me to yourself. Lead me, Lord, I pray. Take me, mold me, use me, fill me.
Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Hey, church family, welcome back from worship. Wasn't that worship so good? So thankful for those two ladies coming together and spending time with us and leading us in worship tonight. Thank you so much for joining us in this series. We've been in the Name of God series for about 4 weeks now. This is the fourth week. This is probably the last part of this series. We're going to go into something different in May, but the Names of God series has been great, and I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. We really focused on Jehovah Jireh, the Lord is my provider, Jehovah Nisi, the Lord is my banner in victory, Jehovah Rapha, and then this week we're going to dive into Jehovah Shalom. And Jehovah-Shalom is probably the name of God that's pertains most to our situation currently, with everything everyone is going through, everything, you know, because not only do we have normal life issues, but we have it on top of a pandemic. You know, so there's a pandemic going on, and then with the pandemic that's going on, we also have these normal life issues that come up. There's still people with illnesses other than COVID-19. There's still people who are dealing with grief from losing loved ones in other ways. There's still financial struggles. There's things that are still happening outside of the realm of just what COVID-19 has done and is doing in our community, in our state, in our world. So Jehovah Shalom, which is the Lord is peace, is actually what we need probably the most right now in this season is peace. And I don't know about you, but I absolutely love when the peace of God comes over me, and especially when I'm in a situation that's out of my control, something I feel like I can't deal with on my own. And the peace of God just floats over, and just kind of like you just take a deep breath and you rest. It's like walking out in sunshine when you haven't been out in the sunshine in a while. It's like that first step into the water at the beach. You know, it's just a moment of calm. And when the Lord's peace comes over you, that's what he does. He just calms your spirit. And when your spirit is calmed, it's so much better than when you're frustrated or struggling or dealing with issues in our life. Because then we know that even if the situation hasn't changed, that God is still in the middle of it, that God is still on the throne, that he's still in control, and his peace is sustainable even when we're going through the storm, even when we're going through a situation. So if you would turn with me to Judges chapter 6, that's where we're going to be studying out of tonight. It's the story of Gideon, which is one of my favorite stories in the Bible. But that's where we find in the Old Testament the first time the name of the Lord was named, I am the Lord, your peace. So I am the Lord, your peace is Jehovah Shalom. So we're going to be reading starting in verse 22, and we're just going to read through to 24, and then we'll kind of dig in to where Gideon is in this moment. But this is the particular verses where Gideon calls the Lord, you are the Lord my God, who is peace, you know, and he calls him his peace because he recognizes that he needed him in that moment. So starting in verse 22, it reads like this. Now Gideon perceived that he was the angel of the Lord. So Gideon said, alas, O Lord God, for I have seen the angel of the Lord face to face. Now, my personal belief is, and the way that the Bible is written, my personal belief is this was Jesus. This was a pre-incarnate Jesus in the Old Testament appearing to Gideon and talking to him. There's several places in the Old Testament where you see the angel of the Lord, and it's lowercase. And those are typically messengers of God. But then sometimes you will see the angel of the Lord in uppercase, and then Gideon clearly says, I have seen the Lord face to face in this scripture. My personal belief is this is Jesus pre-incarnate in the Old Testament as a part of the Trinity appearing to Gideon to strengthen him for what Gideon was going to have to go through. So Gideon said, alas, O Lord God, for I have seen the angel of the Lord face to face. Verse 23, then the Lord said to him, and notice it said, then the Lord said to him. It didn't say the angel of the Lord there. It said, the Lord said to him. That's another indicator that this is Jesus Christ, who is peace. The Lord said to him, peace be with you. Do not fear. You shall not die. Doesn't that sound like something Jesus would say? It absolutely is. You know, there's many times in the New Testament we see Jesus speak, and it's recorded in record in the Gospels where he said, peace be still, or peace be with you, or my peace I give to you. Jesus said it a lot. So he says to him, peace be with you, do not fear, you shall not die. So Gideon built an altar there to the Lord and called it the Lord is peace. He called it the Lord is peace, which is Jehovah Shalom. So to this day, it's still in Ophrah of the Abiezrites. So the story of Gideon is one of my absolute favorites because Gideon represents every person. I mean, Gideon represents me. Gideon represents you. Gideon didn't do the amazing things that he did for God out of his own power, under his own abilities, but he just did it out of pure obedience to what God had asked him to do. So God had asked him to do something, he stepped out in it and did it. So we find ourselves in a season when the children of Israel are really just oppressed by the Midianites, so much so that the Midianites would rove the countryside and just take their food. They would steal from them. They would just walk into households and take what they had. So the Israelites were hiding and cowering in fear. And I don't know about you, but this pandemic and this virus and the stuff that's going on in the world today has a lot of people hiding and cowering in fear, you know, very fearful and worried, and even stocking up food in the background, stocking up toilet paper, you know, hoarding those kind of things. And it's just human nature. It's something that you feel like, oh gosh, if I don't do this, my family's not going to be taken care of. And we find Gideon in this place that he's kind of doing the same thing. We pick up in the story where Gideon has met the angel of the Lord, but where the angel appeared to him was under a tree in Ophrah. And he was under this tree, and what was he doing? He was threshing wheat in a wine press. He was hiding from the enemy. So he was storing up food and threshing wheat inside of a wine press so the enemy wouldn't know what he was doing and come and take his wheat from him, right? So he was cowering, hiding in fear, and storing up food. So that's kind of similar to the situation that we see today, you know, across the nation, across the world, really, that people are storing up food and trying to make sure that they have enough for themselves because of the enemy, COVID-19, and the pandemic and the things that it's doing to our society. But Gideon was doing this back in Judges because of the Midianites, which were his enemy during this time. So Gideon does represent every person. He represents every one of us in this season because it is true that none of us supernaturally can overcome the enemy on our own, right? We need God to supernaturally overcome the enemy. We need God to supernaturally know and understand and have peace in the middle of a storm, in the middle of a pandemic, in the middle of a situation. We need God to be able to have peace in a situation like this. So Gideon is hoarding wheat. The Lord comes to Gideon and asks him to do something very challenging. The Lord comes to Gideon and asks him to do something out of the box, something that Gideon wasn't comfortable with. So the first thing the Lord said to Gideon is, I want you to step out of your comfort zone, right? Now, this isn't what he actually said in the scripture, but this is indeed what he was asking Gideon to do, right? He said, Gideon, I want you to step out of your comfort zone in this season. Gideon, I want you to do something that I'm asking you to do. The next thing he asked him to do is he asked you to call out the sins of your own father, Gideon. Gideon, I want you to call out the sins of your own father by tearing down the altar that your own father created in the middle of town where everybody is worshiping Baal and worshiping images that aren't God, right? So he's asking Gideon, step out of your comfort zone, do something that I've called you to do, tear down the altars of your father, call out your father's sins publicly, and make sure that that altar is destroyed. And then he asks him to do something else. Now, this is a man that's hiding in a wine press, and he asks him, I want you to be a general of the troops of Israel fighting Midian and going after Midian. So how many of you know that this was definitely stepping out of the box for Gideon? This is something completely different for him if he was hiding and threshing in a wine press. Matter of fact, Gideon returns to the angel, and as the angel asks him to do this, he says, who am I? You know, my tribe or my family is the least of all the families. And he said, and I am the least of my family, right? But how many of you know God usually uses the underdog to do amazing things? God will grab someone who you would think would be least qualified or least eligible to do what God has called him to do. And why does he do that? So that he can get all the glory. So if you feel today like you just can't get through a situation that you're in, or you just can't overcome a storm that's in your life, can I tell you today that if you feel like you're powerless against whatever is facing you, that's a great place to be, because that means you trust completely in the Lord. That means you trust completely in God. And if you trust completely in the Lord and completely in God, He will see you through. He absolutely will see you through. So he asked him to be general and lead troops. The next thing he asked him to do is stand up against the enemy that everybody had been hiding from. Not just Gideon, the whole children of Israel, the whole group had been hiding from this enemy, right? So he asked him to stand up against this enemy and stand up for the place of God. So Gideon was without doubt feeling pressure in this moment, wouldn't you say? I would absolutely say that Gideon felt so much pressure in this moment, because he knew this is God, he knew it was the Lord, and he knew he needed to do what God had asked him to do, but it wasn't in his physical abilities to do what God had asked him to do. You know, hiding in a wine press, scared of the Midianites, it wasn't in his physical abilities to do it. He wasn't some great military leader, and yet God had asked him to be the general, to step up, to lead the people. Of course, the first thing he asked them to do was abolish the altar that they had been sacrificing to false gods and get rid of that before he went into battle. How many of you know that when you're dealing with issues and you're dealing with pressure situations in your life and you know you're facing something, the first and foremost thing you need to do is get with God, right? And make sure that you're okay with Him. Make sure there's nothing you need to eliminate before you go into battle. That's something that it's important that we do. So Gideon was feeling a pressure. I wonder if you've ever felt pressure like Gideon felt in this moment. You know, maybe you're feeling pressure today with something, and it may have nothing to do with the pandemic. It might be other situations, or it might have everything to do with the pandemic. But I wonder if you feel pressure in your life today. I wonder if you're struggling with anything in your life, or at any point in time, can you recall a time when you felt so much pressure on you that you felt like you were being crushed? There's all kinds of reasons for pressure that you may have in your life. Job stress. Job stress can create so much pressure. It can create a situation where you feel out of control, right? Job stress can be pressure in your life. Marriage and family stress. Marriage and family stress can be so much pressure, right? If your marriage is struggling or you're not hitting on all cylinders and you're having a rough moment, you know, that can cause so much stress and pressure in your life. Or maybe your kids aren't doing what you've asked them to do, or they're stepping out from what you've taught them, you know? That can cause a lot of pressure in your life. Is something that you feel intense pressure over. How about financial stress? Financial stress can be so pressurizing in your environment. It can create such a pressure cooker type environment for you because you may not see a way out of your situation. Or maybe it's just coronavirus stress, coronavirus pressure, you know, pressure with what's going on in the world and what's going on in the situation. And maybe you're out of work, or maybe you're unable to work because of what's going on, or maybe your hours have been cut, or, you know, all of that's kind of affecting you, and you just need to, you've been stuck in the house, you know, that whatever that stress has been happening in your life. Or maybe it's personal failures, you know, something that's just happened in your life and you just failed. You know, you made a mistake, you messed up, you know, and because you messed up, you have heavy consequences for it. And that can create a pressurized situation in your life. That can create a symptom of stress or pressure in your life is just, I've had a personal failure. I've done something wrong or reacted in a wrong way or failed at something I was trying to achieve, you know, and just did not make it. You know, that can require that kind of stress in your life. How about times of transition? Times of transition can be totally pressure-filled and stressful. You're unsure about the future. You're unsure about the next step that you're taking. You're unsure about the move. You know, you're unsure. About a year ago, Jessica and I made a transition from a previous job, previous church, to a new church, new position here at First AG Emerness, and that was a pressure-filled transition. There was a lot of stress, pressure involved in that. There was one particular season that I felt the most pressure in my life, and it was when I was first coming into ministry. So I knew that God had come to me and called me and told me to do ministry. I didn't know what that looked like, and I didn't know what the next step I was supposed to take was. I felt so much pressure in my secular job because I didn't want to be there anymore because I knew God was calling me out to a new season. And I remember it all came to a head one day when I was so full of pressure at work, and I had a moment of explosion at work. And it's not, wasn't like me typically to explode or blow up, especially on someone who pays my paychecks, you know, but I blew up on my boss and yelled at him. He yelled at me. It was a bad situation. He told me to go home. You know, and in that moment, I recognized, gosh, I've got so much pressure inside of me that it's like a pressure cooker. And it was like flipping a relief valve. I don't know if you've ever used a pressure cooker, or maybe an Instant Pot, which is an electric pressure cooker that's pretty famous today that a lot of people are using. It's pretty popular. But if you ever use an Instant Pot and you cook for something for 20 minutes and then you flip that manual switch at the top to do the pressure release, all of a sudden all this stuff starts, you know, and it swelters up your whole kitchen, turns into a steam sauna, you know. You see water dripping off of wherever the pressure cooker is above it. You know, water's kind of dripping off, condensation, because this big pressure release happened. And that's kind of what happened to me that day. It was a moment of stress and pressure, and all this had been boiling up, and all of a sudden a switch got flipped, and I had this moment of pressure release. And I went home, and I was so, like, just distraught. you know, and I walk in and there's a birthday party going on at my house, you know, at the time. And I'm like, oh, great. You know, I'm having the worst day and there's a birthday party going on that I've got to put a smile on my face for, but I just couldn't do it. Have you ever just been unable to fake it? You know, unable to put a smile on your face when everything's going bad and you're just in that moment where it's just not, you're not capable of it, right? So I walked in, went straight to my bedroom, and I remember laying on the floor and just crying out to God. And my wife came in and she's like, what are you doing? And I'm like, baby, I can't be out there. I can't be around people. I'm so stressed. I'm dying here, you know, and I'm on the floor with my face buried in the carpet, just crying out to God. And Jessica says, no, you got to get up and go help me with this party. And then she looked in my eyes and she realized I was incapable of doing it in that moment. I had so much pressure. She stepped out of the room and I didn't see, but I heard voices. And my mother-in-law came in and she got down and she was laying hands on my head and just praying. My wife was pacing back and forth beside me and getting down on her knees and laying her hand on my back and praying. And then I heard two dear friends of mine, Ken and Ingrid, and they walked in and they began to sing praise and worship, and they began to just sing, and it filled the atmosphere in the room. And I remember going from having such a pressure over me to just a complete calm in that moment. And that's what God's presence does. When God's presence comes into your situation, there's a complete calm. So there's a moment of pressure, and then it just releases, right? It just, and there's just a calm, you know, because God's presence has really filled this place. So the New Testament mentions of God, you know, so in the Old Testament, that was the one and only time that where he built an altar to God and named it Jehovah-Shalom. You know, the Lord is your peace, right? He named it that. But there's plenty of times in the New Testament where we see Jesus speaking and otherwise where it talks about peace in your situations, right? John 16:33, and this is Jesus speaking, says this, I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. So in Jesus is where we find peace. John 14:27 says this, and this is Jesus speaking again. Peace I leave with you. Does this sound like the angel of the Lord Jesus who met Gideon behind the tree at Ophrah, right? Peace be still, my peace I give to you. Be in peace because you shall not die. You know, this is Jesus talking. And in John 14:27, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. I think that's absolutely just, bar none, some of the best words for your situation is Jesus looking at you and saying, do not be afraid. My peace I give to you. Whatever situation you're dealing with, don't be afraid. My peace I give to you. Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 8. Reads like this, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, and that's not where it stops. Right, it continues into the next scripture. Sometimes we just read that portion, but it continues into the next scripture. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. So it's not just a matter of crying out to God, but it's a matter of practicing what he has asked us to practice. That means what we're thinking about, what we're believing, what we're speaking about, what we're focusing on. If we focus on good things and the goodness of God, even in a rough situation, if we're just focusing on the goodness of God, it will help the God of peace will be with you, but it'll help the peace of God to reign over you and rest over top of you. And I think that is absolutely incredible. So we see that in the New Testament echoes, I am the Lord who gives you peace, using phrases like this, the God of peace, the peace of God, my peace I give to you. Isaiah 9:6 refers to the coming Messiah, Jesus Christ, as the Prince of Peace. I don't know about you, but that's awesome. He calls him the Prince of Peace. That he owns peace. He reigns over peace. He owns peace that he can distribute to you. So we may not own peace, but we serve a Lord who owns peace, that owns it so well and so much that he can distribute it to us in the times that we need it. I think that's awesome, right? So shalom, the Hebrew word used for peace, means this. It means wholeness, security, well-being, prosperity, peace, and friendship. So shalom means all of those things. So basically shalom is a common Jewish greeting when they say shalom, my brother, shalom, my sister. It's a common greeting with saying all of these things I desire for you. Right? All of these things I desire for you. So when we trust Jesus with our life and we give him our life, he says, shalom, brother, shalom, sister, shalom, children. These are the things that I wish for you. I wish you to have wholeness, security, well-being, prosperity, peace, and friendship. I wish all of these things upon you. So God is saying, I bestow these things on you, but through relationship with me, right? So as we enter into relationship with Jesus, these are natural attributes of that relationship that gets bestowed upon us because we're in relationship with him. So how do we find peace of God or find the God of peace through circumstances and situations or we find Jehovah Shalom in the situations that we're currently in? Here's three easy points about scriptures that we've read today and kind of tying up everything that we've talked about. Number one, run straight to the Lord first. I'm going to say that again because there's a key word there. Run straight to the Lord first, right? Run to the Lord first before we go to anybody else. Nobody else gets this place in your life. When you're feeling struggling and worried and fearful and you just don't know what to do, run straight to the Lord. Go to the Lord first before you go to anybody else, right? Don't run to the Lord after you've exhausted all other options. Don't run to the Lord only after everyone else isn't available. You know, fall on your knees in front of him first and foremost. Lay on your face in front of him and just go to him first, because he's the only one who owns peace and can give you a portion of it. He's the only one who reigns and rules over peace that he can distribute out to you. So we go to the Lord first. He gets the first opportunity, not the second, not the fourth, not the last opportunity, not the last ditch effort. He gets the first opportunity to give you peace in the middle of your situation. Number two, check your heart before him. Check your heart before him. Is there anything between you and God? Is there something you're hanging on to in your heart? Is there some kind of bitterness or unforgiveness or something that you're just like got a hold of and you've just refused to give up and you've refused to hand over? You know, is there something between you and God that you need to give up before you go into battle, before you have the peace of God surround you to go into battle? Repent. Repent to your brother or sister or somebody that has something against you or you have something against them. Repent. Give it up to God. So run to the Lord first. Check your heart. Go before God. You'll see this with King David a lot and in the Psalms as he would cry out to God and he would talk about what a wretch he is and what a sinful man he's been and the things that he's done wrong. But then about halfway through the Psalm, you'll see a flip. And he goes from talking about what a wretch he is and how low he is to how great our God is, right? So go to God with the issues that you have. If there's a need for repentance, repent, you know, before him and tell him what you're sorry for, what you need forgiveness for. Take that to the Lord first. And then the third one is this, get alone with God and cry out to him. Get alone with God and cry out to him. There's nothing wrong with crying out to God, right? Matter of fact, there's a whole book of the Bible called Lamentations, and what lamenting is crying out to God, right? Doesn't need to be the entirety of your prayer, but that sure is a place you can start. You know, you totally start with crying out to God and telling him your situation and telling him your struggles so that you can indeed flip it around and talk about to him how awesome he is and how powerful he is over top and above your struggles, so that you get it in the right perspective so that you can transfer that struggle to him in the midst of that prayer, right? So that he can take your anxieties and he can take your worries and your concerns and he can give you peace. It's a transaction. So when we go to the Lord this way, we pray a transaction. God, I'm willing to give you all the things that are causing turmoil in my life, and I'm willing to accept in exchange for that your peace. I'm here. I'm going to accept your calmness. Lord, I'm going to take what it is you have for me, and I'm going to give you the things that I'm carrying that I can't carry on my own, right? And God helps you in that situation. So there's no better place to lay down your burdens than at the altar or at the feet of Jesus. That's the best place to lay down your burdens. There's no one else who has the power of your situation. Nobody else reigns over peace. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. Judges 6:7 says this, "Now it came about when the sons of Israel cried to the Lord on the account of Midian." So because the people had cried out to God, he answered their plea. The people had been crying out to God because Midian had been so hard on them. And the Lord went to Gideon and raised up Gideon and used him to create a space for freedom of the children of Israel between them and the Midianites. He used them to conquer Midian and send them running so that Midian no longer had the stranglehold on Israel that it had before. So Gideon, as a man of God, delivered Israel from the Midianites. He restored the people back to proper worship in Jehovah-Shalom, right? So Judges 9:28 says this, "Thus Midian was subdued before the children of Israel, so they lifted their heads no more, and the country was quiet for 40 years in the days of Gideon." So because Gideon was obedient to the Lord and did what the Lord asked him to do, then the Lord supernaturally won the battle for the children of Israel. And because of that, their country was quiet for the next 40 years. And what that means is they had peace. Peace reigned in Israel for the next 40 years. But how many of you know Gideon was just a man, right? Gideon was a broken man. He was just a man. He had issues just like anybody else. And after Gideon was used by God mightily to bring increase to Israel and to bring freedom to his country and to Israel, and although he was used by God mightily, he got caught up in his own fame. And as he set up a golden ephod under a tree where the Lord had called him. So he took pounds and pounds of gold from the people, and he built this ephod out of gold, and he probably did it with decent intentions, but it didn't turn out that way because it wasn't something the Lord asked him to do. And he set up an ephod underneath the tree where God had met him and called him. So he probably had the best of intentions, but what happened is people began to worship that ephod instead of worship God. Right, people would begin to come and pray and kneel to the ephod instead of kneeling and worshiping God. So he messed up in the end. But can I tell you this? Our deliverer today is not a man. Our deliverer today is not a president. Our deliverer today is not a governor. Our deliverer today is not politicians. Our deliverer today is not a pastor. Our deliverer today is not a husband or a father. Our deliverer today is Jesus Christ. And Jesus is perfect in all his ways. So although Gideon was used mightily by God and met him under a tree and was obedient and did God's will, he ended up leading the people into the wrong kind of worship again. And then it says when Gideon died, the people went right back to worshiping Baal. So as soon as Gideon died, so what does that mean? That means that they were worshiping Gideon and the altar that he created more than they were worshiping God. They were giving Gideon more credit than they gave God. So the moment Gideon died, 40 years later, the people immediately returned to Baal worship. And God had to raise up another judge to come in and set the children of Israel straight. The awesome thing is today, our deliverer is Jesus Christ. Our deliverer is perfect in all his ways. Our deliverer will never fail us. He will never leave us nor forsake us. So if we put our faith in Jesus Christ as our deliverer, we never will be failed. We'll never be disappointed. Amen. So listen, church, I thank you so much for joining us for this Bible study today. And listen, there may be some of you out there who need to put your faith in Jesus. And maybe you're watching this today and you don't even know why. You know, you just stopped on it, started watching it, and you need Jesus in your life. You need a Savior. You need somebody to bring you peace because you don't know peace or don't understand peace. Can I tell you today, it's as easy as ABC. One, you acknowledge that you need Jesus in your life. Two, you believe that he died on a cross for your sins to make you white as snow. And then three, or C, you confess with your mouth that he is Lord and Savior, and you invite him with your mouth into your life. It's as easy as doing those three things, and it's as simple as a prayer I'm going to pray next. And if you're at home right now and you need to receive Jesus in your life, all you have to do is pray this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I recognize I need you. Lord, I believe that you died on a cross for me. Please forgive me of my sins. I recognize that you are Lord, that you are God, and I invite you into my life. I place all my trust on you, Lord, and I ask that your peace reign supreme in my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So listen, if you just said that prayer for the first time, welcome to the family. I'm so glad that you received Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And for the rest of the church that's home tonight, and we're unable to meet in person yet, but I know the day is coming soon when we'll be able to meet in person, even with some restrictions, but we'll be able to meet in person soon. But this coming Sunday, we're going to live stream from the stage, from the pulpit again, and I'm excited to get back behind the pulpit and preaching behind the pulpit again after I haven't done it for the entire month of April. I'm excited to do that. We're still unable to open the doors as far as I know yet, but if something changes between then and now, I will sure make an announcement and let you know. But this coming Sunday, join us live at 10:30 on YouTube or Facebook, and our praise team and myself are going to be live. And we're just expecting God to do amazing things and continue to show up and show out in our situations. But those of you that are home, maybe you haven't been feeling peaceful lately. Maybe you've been carrying anxiety or pressure or stress or worry. Can I challenge you that after this broadcast ends, to go find a quiet spot and just get on your face before God and cry out to him? Even if it's just internal things, you haven't told anybody else, you haven't talked to anybody else about it, but it's just an internal struggle that you have. Can I tell you to just get on your face and cry out and tell God and just ask God to meet you where you are and just expect, go with an expectation of that peace resting over you from top to bottom and just imagine stepping into God's ocean, stepping out into God's sunlight and just feeling that peace just come over you, all your muscles just relax, your anxiety just kind of melts away, those stomach flips and turns and butterflies just ease, and just you feel joyful, you feel full of peace, and that's what God does for us, that's what Jesus does for us. So let me challenge you to do that as soon as this video ends, okay? I'm going to pray us out for this evening, and thank you again to all of you who have continued to be faithful to the church and continuing to support the work of the ministry, both in your prayer and in your finances. And thank you to those who have been supporting us with working behind the scenes to bring us worship and the media stuff and working to do everything. I just thank you all for diving in and doing ministry in an unprecedented way in an unprecedented time. But I'm thankful. So let's pray us out this evening. Father, thank you for the opportunity yet again, Lord. And I know I thank you a lot for this, but I believe you deserve all the credit that we can come together as a church family and we can just praise your name even in separate locations. Thank you that we can do that. Thank you, Lord, for the equipment that we have that you've provided us with to do these things for you. Father, I pray your peace over every household in our church. I pray your peace over every situation. Lord, that you would just do miracles in households during this season. And then when this season is over, Lord, and we go back to life, we go back to in-church services, Father, I pray that we would not go back to normal, not go back to the same, Lord, but we go somewhere completely different, that we grab a gear and go to a new level with you. Lord, bring us all to a new level. And we give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, church. I'll see you Sunday morning live from behind my pulpit. Amen.